how long would it take us to go to Neptune? Did you know that with our technology, we have only been able to go to Neptune one time in all of history? Yeah, believe it or not, Neptune is so far away that even our fastest spacecraft would take more than a decade to get there. Also, without a group of astronauts set out to travel to the last planet in the solar system, they would not have enough fuel to return to Earth. But why is it difficult to reach the planet Neptune? How long would it take us to reach that planet with modern technology, and why have we only been there once? Stay with us to answer all of those questions. Have we only gone once? Although it sounds hard to believe, the ice giant Neptune has only been visited by a single spacecraft in all of human history. And that spacecraft was the Voyager 2 probe, which passed close to Neptune's orbit in 1989. The Voyager 2 probe was part of the Voyager mission, which consisted of two space exploration probes, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2, whose main objective was to study the outer planets, about which, until then, very little was known. One of the most compelling reasons for these spaceships to be designed is because on those dates, a significant event would occur that would not be repeated for more than a century. That event was a planetary alignment occurring every 176 years between Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. The idea was that the Voyager exploration probes would take advantage of this unique planetary alignment to achieve speeds that could not be achieved with any fuel, using something that we have already talked about on this channel, the gravity assist. The only way to travel without fuel. Gravity assist is a space maneuver in which a ship uses a planet's gravity to change its speed and direction. Used in missions such as Voyager, it saves fuel and accelerates spaceships to speeds that they would never reach with conventional fuel to reach their objectives in less time. Gravity assist works like this. When a ship approaches a planet, it falls into the gravitational well generated by the planet's mass, causing it to gain speed and accelerate. If the ship doesn't change course, it will eventually fall towards the planet. But if it has thrusters that allow it to stay far enough from the planet, it will pick up speed and continue on its new trajectory. This technique allows spacecraft to explore multiple destinations in a single mission and reach greater distances in less time, but it has a downside. The disadvantage is that it only works if there are planets in your path. So you must take advantage of the moments in which they are aligned, and this does not always happen. If the Voyager ships were able to get so far, it was because they took advantage of a particular planetary alignment in which the four gas giant planets would be very close to each other, thus taking advantage of the gravity of the four planets. The spaceships were able to acquire the necessary speed to leave the solar system. The Voyager 1 mission took advantage of this alignment in its close flyby of Jupiter in 1979. Voyager 2, on the other hand, used a series of planetary gravity assists to pass Jupiter 1979, Saturn 1981, Uranus 1986, and finally reached Neptune in 1989. Thanks to this, the Voyager 2 probe became the first artifact created by the human race to reach the last planet in the solar system. Voyager 2 Voyage. Voyager 2 was launched in 1977 and undertook an epic journey through the outer solar system. It used gravity assistance from Jupiter and Saturn during its journey to head towards more distant planets. In August 1989, after more than a decade of journey, Voyager 2 approached Neptune, becoming the first and only spacecraft to explore this planet up close. During its flyby of Neptune, Voyager 2 captured stunning images of the planet, its rings, and its moons. It discovered features like the Great Dark Spot, a vortex similar to Jupiter's Great Red Spot. It also observed swift gusts of wind in Neptune's upper atmosphere, exceeding 2,000 kilometers per hour. Voyager 2's flyby of Neptune provided valuable information about this remote gas giant and its system, contributing significantly to our understanding of the outer planets and beyond. However, it must be remembered that Voyager 2 did not stay on Neptune, but continued to the stars. If we wanted Voyager 2 to remain in orbit of Neptune, we would have to consider the braking time, the time it would take for the spacecraft to slow down to land in Neptune's orbit without shooting off into space. How's that? Isn't it enough to slam on the brakes like a car would? No. In space, things move very fast. Planets, comets, spaceships, everything. For a spacecraft to stay in orbit, a planet needs to have the same orbital velocity as that planet. Orbital velocity. To better explain this, imagine a car race. In car races, all the cars go at extremely high speeds. And although each car moves at different speeds, they all go so fast that if one of the drivers were to brake suddenly, at the moment of pressing the brake pedal, it would not stay in the place where it braked, but would advance several tens of meters until it braked completely. The same thing happens in the case of spaceships. When they leave Earth, they must reach very high speeds to escape the gravity of our planet. And each time they pass through a planet to take advantage of gravitational assistance, they acquire more and more speed. All the planets in the solar system orbit the Sun at different speeds. Neptune has an orbital speed of 3.38 miles per second. This means that if we wanted to place a ship orbiting Neptune, it would have to reach that speed, since if it had a slower speed, it would never reach the planet in its journey around the Sun. And if it did, once the planet's force of gravity catches it, it will pull it until the spaceship crashes into the planet, because it does not have enough speed to overcome the force of gravity. Conversely, if a spacecraft moved much faster than Neptune's orbital speed, its speed would send it flying off the planet. The only way to land on the planet is by acquiring an orbital velocity similar to and exceeding the escape velocity. And this is where the big problem lies. When the Voyager 2 probe used gravity assist to increase its speed while passing close to the gas giant planets, it ended up reaching a speed of 9.6313 miles per second. That is, it was three times faster than the orbital speed of Neptune. To be placed in the orbit of Neptune, the ship would have to perform a braking process with thrusters that slowed down to a third. The Voyager probes did not have the objective of landing in the orbit of any planet, so this maneuver was impossible to carry out. But if a human crewed mission of astronauts wanted to land in the orbit of Neptune, how would they do the braking process? The only way to slow down to land on Neptune is with propulsion engines, and a human-crewed spacecraft is much larger than a space exploration probe, meaning they would need a lot more fuel. Braking is not so easy in space. Although it seems like a simple process, stopping a spaceship that is going so fast is not an easy task. In fact, it is something that has never been done in the history of space exploration. We've seen spacecraft accelerate upon entering the atmosphere of planets like Mars or Earth. Still, we have never slowed down a ship going faster than 9.6313 miles per second and placed it in orbit around a planet. A spacecraft the size of Voyager 2 would need an amount of fuel equivalent to more than 10 times its weight to carry out the braking process, which would take between 1 and 2 months. Yes, just as you heard, in a car race when braking, these continue to advance a few meters. In space, the ships continue to advance several thousand kilometers after starting to brake. The reason again is speed. To reach Neptune, the Voyager probe had to reach a very high speed, but consequently, the braking process to stay on Neptune would be very slow. Now, in the case of a human-crewed spacecraft with four astronauts, this would be at least 20 times bigger and heavier than the Voyager probe. That is, it would need 20 times more fuel to brake and 20 times more time or even more to stop a space exploration probe than a human-crewed spacecraft with human beings. Let's imagine that in 120 years, when the planetary alignment of the four gas planets happens again, we launch the first human-crewed spaceship bound for Neptune, with four brave astronauts on board who will replicate the same journey that Voyager 2 took in the 1980s. Passing through Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and finally Neptune. Suppose those calculations are correct and take advantage of all the gravitational assists. In theory, they should reach Neptune in a period very similar to that of Voyager 2, that is, 12 years. But it may take them a little longer since a manned spacecraft is much larger and heavier than a scanning probe. Also, astronauts cannot be subjected to massive G-forces, so they would not be able to take advantage of gravity assist as Voyager 2 did. If the spacecraft in which the astronauts travel is 20 times heavier than Voyager 2, It's likely that instead of taking 12 years, the trip will take 22 to 24 years. But even reducing the risks of being subjected to the G-forces by gravity assists, the astronauts will not be able to stay on that planet unless they break. And this is where the difficulty begins. When braking a human-crewed spacecraft, passengers submit to the inertial force they experience from being in a deceleration process. The human body cannot withstand great forces, so the spacecraft braking process of carrying astronauts to Neptune will have to be very slow. How slow? Possibly it takes them between 2 and 4 years. As you just heard, it takes 2 to 4 years just to slow down, meaning that the complete journey from Earth to Neptune should take between 24 and 28 years. And that, using all available resources such as propulsion rockets, special planetary alignment, gravitational assists, etc. Isn't it incredible that even taking advantage of all these resources available to humanity, it takes us almost 3 decades to reach the last planet in the solar system? In addition, we are talking about a trip with no return, since the fuel we are considering for this video will be used only for the braking process. Once the astronauts arrive at Neptune, they will not have the fuel to return to Earth. If we wanted to calculate a spaceship with fuel to return to Earth, the spaceship would have to be 1,000 times bigger. Let's not forget that more than 90% of spacecraft is just fuel. So the fuel needed to go from Neptune to Earth would be overwhelming, much more than all the rockets humanity launched in history have ever used. And you, do you think we will be able to send humans to Neptune? Or will we have to wait for space travel technology to change? Let us know your opinion in the comments.